Covalent bonding can occur in elements and in compounds. In elements, we've already seen covalent compounds in the diatomic elements: hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, chlorine, fluorine, bromine, and iodine. Those elements exist as covalent diatomic molecules. We also see covalent bonding in compounds. This type of bonding occurs when the atoms within the compound have similar electronegativity. Electronegativity is the attraction for that particular atom for the shared pair of electrons in the bond. If the electronegativity is similar, then the electrons will be shared equally or nearly equally between the two nuclei that are held together by this covalent bond. So the bond is a shared pair of valence electrons. That's why it's called covalent. And we see this largely occurring in the nonmetals. They all have similar electronegativities. And so nonmetal with nonmetal, there's not a greater attraction for the electron in one than the other. And so rather than the electron completely leaving the valence shell to forming a cation and an anion, rather in this situation, in the case of the nonmetals, we normally see covalent bonding or sharing pairs of electrons. And this is a good way, this image over here, to model a hydrogen atom and a free hydrogen atom. The plus is the nucleus, one proton, and all of these dots are representing the places where the one electron, is likely to be. Close to the nucleus is the highest probability of where you'll find that electron in each of these atoms. But when you start bringing those two atoms together, the position of the lowest energy for the electron is no longer equally dispersed around some sphere around the proton. Rather, now there's a more of a chance that you'll find the electrons between the two protons. And then finally, at a certain distance, the two nuclei are essentially held together by sharing the two electrons, one from each of those atoms. And so we end up then with a diatomic hydrogen molecule. Now, why does this happen this way? Well, it's just like why, again, a ball rolls downhill. The electrons are going to move to the lowest energy state. The atoms are ex going to exist in the lowest energy state. And so the two free atoms with their own electrons will have some energy that's higher than two atoms that are getting closer together versus the two atoms that have found the sweet spot and will be held together at this distance from one another, sharing the pair of electrons which are most likely to be found between the two nuclei. If the atoms get pushed together closer, the energy starts going up quite rapidly due to the repulsion between the positively charged nuclear repulsion. Okay, and so there's this sweet spot where there's an opposite attraction between a negatively charged electron, positively charged nucleus, versus the repulsion of the two electrons and the two protons, because like charges repel. So this is how we end up with covalent molecules. Now, the covalent molecules occur mostly in nonmetals. So what you need to do is you need to be able to identify whether or not a molecule or a compound, excuse me, is a covalent compound or not. And you also need to be able to name compounds, covalent compounds. All right, this is the subject of the next learning module. But for now, it's important to note that the molecular compounds are not held to a certain ratio. For example, if you have the chloride of phosphorus, you could have a chloride that has five chlorines or three. Whereas if you have the chloride of sodium or another metal, there you're only going to have one opportunity because the sodium is going to carry a plus one charge, the chloride is going to carry a minus one charge, and you're going to be held to a one-to-one ratio. However, with these molecular compounds, we can have varieties of ratios because we're not forming full positive and full negative charge. Rather, we're sharing pairs of electrons. And we saw that in the case of the ionic compounds, the charge dependent on the position on the periodic table and achieving that noble gas configuration. In the case of the covalent compounds, which we will practice later with Lewis structures, we find that the bonding is dictated again by satisfying the octet rule or having a noble gas configuration, but it is achieved rather than by donating or gaining electrons, rather by sharing electrons. So at this point, you just need to be able to recognize whether or not a compound is covalent or ionic, and you're going to recognize it based on whether or not the compound is completely composed of nonmetals. If it is, then chances are you would say that that particular compound is covalent, and it's going to follow a different naming system that you'll learn in the next learning module.